So, hello, my name is Petr Mládek and I am kernel developer at SUSE, focusing on live patching and printk and other stuff. And today I would like to talk about how to better integrate some extra features provided by the live patching support in kernel for the live patches. So let me first explain what these features are about. So like the basic functionality of live patches is basically to redirect the buggy functions to the new code that is included in the live patch module. That's the basic infrastructure and sometimes functionality. Sometimes it's not enough, sometimes it's needed for the new code to actually work to, I don't know, convert some data or create some extra data or, I don't know, create some mutex or whatever. And for this, there are four callbacks, where one is called before the live patch is enabled, the other one at the end of the transition when all processes on the system already are using the fixed code. And the other are basically reverted when the live patch gets disabled, before and after. Yeah, then there are shadow variables. It's an APR which allows to allocate some memory and associate it with some address. And another API allows to get this data for the address and so on. And the problem was that actually these callbacks and shadow variables might be used by more live patches, either when they are installed in parallel, or most people are probably, most users are using that atomic replace. So the new version actually would want to do the same changes, but it doesn't have to do when the previous live patch already did the changes called these callbacks. Or regarding the shadow variables, when the new version might not longer use this. So actually the shadow variables should be freed because they will not longer be used. Or when there is a downgrade, that they should be released as well. And so this was not well supported. So we introduced Clipper States API, which allows to define like states with some ID and an API that the callbacks were able to check if this state was in the previous, if the current live patch, or if they exist in the new live patch that is being enabled, and so on. And now let's see how these are integrated. I try to show it in some pictures, how the kernel core knows about this. So when the live patch modules is installed, then it actually passes some structure with the live patch data to kernel to by this KLP enable patch function, and this structure contains array of structure for objects which split the live patch functions for VM Linux and other modules that might be live patch, because the redirection has to be done when these modules are loaded. Then there are this structures object contains array of structures functions that provide information how to do the redirection. And then the original callbacks well also part of this structure object, so that we could have custom callbacks when these live patch modules are loaded. Then the states when we did the states, then we decided that the callbacks in the modules objects were not used, were used rarely or not at all. So we decided to simplify things and put the states just as an array into the patch structure. And yeah, I missed, yeah, that there appear actually shadow variables, and the life the kernel core is not aware about the life shadow variables at all, because there is just API that is used by the callbacks or by the fixed versions of the functions that they allocate and get this data and so on. So actually, it you see that it doesn't like the states are not well fit together with the callbacks and even the shadow variables. The problem with the shadow variables was that if they are not longer used, that the core couldn't free them. Just do some garbage collection and so on. So we could do better. And so it took some discussions, and we came with this proposal to like have the structure patch, structure objects, and keep just the functions in the structure object. And then move the callbacks into the structure state. And actually, it won't be possible to call them when the live patch module is loaded. We will have just callbacks when the state. And also, I propose to change the semantic, or we propose to change the semantic so that the callbacks will be called only when the state is introduced or when the state is not longer used. So it again, it will be pre-transition and post-transition, but when there is the atomic replace and the state was already there and still will be there, then nothing will be called. And another state, it will be actually, we could mark some state that it's related to some shadow variables. And also the shadow variables were distinguished by some ID, and also the states had some ID. So basically we could use the same ID for the state and shadow variables. And so if the new live patch doesn't longer support this state that was related to shadow variables, then we could do simply the garbage collections, even the core. And before, it had to be handled by some callback that had to check that the state was not longer supported and so on. So it was really complicated. So that's it. Here is the summary of the changes that just that the callbacks are actually during the atomic replace, we currently call the callbacks just from the new live patch. And it's historically because it helps like partly with the semantic, because if both patches, if the old package calls this unpatch callbacks and the new patch calls the enable callbacks, then they would maybe mess with each other. Then one would disable the same things and the other one would like to enable it and so on. So it would create problems. So actually, and as a result, the downgrade was not easy because the old patch didn't have these callbacks to basically disable what's not longer supported. But newly, it's about the state, so we could basically call the callbacks from the state structure, so we could call them even from the old patch when the state is not longer supported, because and the old patch needs these callbacks also because when to support disabling the live patch. It's basically the same. Downgrade or disabling is basically the same operation. Yeah, then the garbage collection of shadow variables is simple. And also originally the states had versions which allowed to maintain kind of compatibility. So only live patch with the same states and with or with the higher versions was able to replace the old one. But basically in practice, it's just use that when the live patch, when the changes done by the callbacks are hard to revert, or maybe they're even impossible to get revert, or the author of the live patch don't want to spend time with supporting the revert. So in this case, we could replace the version with just simple flag like blocked, disable, and it will block downgrade and to live patches that no longer support this state, or block disable because the code is not implemented. So at the end, I think that it makes perfect sense, and it all fits much better together. So the limitations are that actually the callbacks won't be will not longer be callbacks when the live patched module is loaded. But the question is if we want to keep them or not. The idea is that actually even the live patch made register their own module notifier, and actually it's much easier to do these changes when the module gets loaded, because actually we might do the do needed modifications before the loaded module gets activated, because before it calls module init, because before calling that module init, it's basically the kernel should not be aware that it's loaded. So there is no need like the pre-transition and post-transition. And the same is that we could revert these changes after calling module exit, because after this, the kernel should no longer use any functionality from that module. So we basically don't need boot callbacks. And another thing that actually, and it's missing on the slides, is that I wonder if we sometimes might need some callback for transitioning this state, like even when the new live patch is still using the state, that I might need to do some action to actually take over the state. I'm not sure if it would be useful in practice or not. Yeah. But it would make the semantics maybe more complicated. I'm not sure if it's worth it.
Yeah, I would propose keep it simple to start with, and then if we have these edge cases, then we can always iterate later. I had one question. So when you associate a shadow variable with a state, is it only, you can only associate one shadow variable?
Yeah, right? Well, it's basically not associating like the data with the state. It's basically just associating the ID. That the state ID will be the same, yeah, like shadow ID. And I implemented the proof of concept, and there is just the, when the kernel is disabling the live patch, and or when replacing, and the new live patch doesn't longer support this shadow variable, this state with shadow variables, it automatically frees does the garbage collection just by calling the shadow variable free all? What's the name?
Yeah, so is that the common case where you only need one shadow variable type for a set of callbacks and for a state? Or is there?
Yeah, well, we would need basically one state for each shadow variable ID, like, because like the ID defines kind of the type. For example, if you are extending the structure, then you need instances of the shadow variable for each structure if it exists more times. But okay. like
so the patch could have multiple states. If it had multiple shadow variable types, it could have one state for each.
No. It would mean like for every, well, no, like you have to distinguish like the shadow variables instances, like the data that are allocated, and that ID of the shadow variables. That ID kind of means the type, or
yeah, right.
We could see it as a type, like this shadow variables is for adding, I don't know, some counter into some structure.
Right. So
and the same kind might be, yeah.
Right. So if one patch needed multiple shadow variable types, it would need, and it wanted them to be garbage collected.
Yeah.
It would need one state. You need multiple states.
Yeah. One for each. Multiple states. It's just because we need to remember the ID of each shadow variable.
Yeah.
And okay. Yeah, it would be possible to make the IDs like list of IDs, but I think that this.
And
is
even if the state didn't have callbacks, it could still exist, right? Still exist for the sake of the shadow variable type.
Yeah. We could create just state without callbacks, just and say that this state is for this shadow variable ID, and yeah, and will be used just for the garbage collection, and it will actually save. Otherwise, we would need the callback just to free down. Yeah.
So from my point of view, this association between shadow variables and states is like only convenience, because you could achieve the same by implementing callbacks freeing the shadow variable you like, mm-hmm. and any number, of course. So
yeah,
it's just.
Yeah, and I wonder if actually this changes basically the API of the live patches. So I wonder if it's acceptable for people using.
It looks good to me. I like it.
Yeah.
Are there more comments or questions? Okay, so thank you.
Yeah.